Okay, thank you all very much for coming today. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to NYU's Jordan Center for the Advanced Study of Russia. I'm Joshua Tucker, I'm the director of the center, and we have a fantastic event lined up for today. I just wanted to go over a couple things just really quickly in the beginning. One, first is to let you know that this event is being brought to you jointly, actually co-sponsored by the University of Pittsburgh's Center for Russian and East European Studies. And as a sort of modern technological way of doing events like this, we're actually live streaming right now. So please know that the event will be live streamed as we're going forward with this. We also really want to thank the Remark Institute and the Center for European and Mediterranean Studies here at NYU for co-sponsoring the event. Larry Wolf, who's the director of the event, director of both centers, I believe at the moment, is here with us today. I want to thank Dean Tom Carew from the Faculty of Arts and Sciences for joining us today here as well. And more than anything else, I would like to thank Dr. Jennifer Wilson for having organized this event. So today's event is called The Global Alt-Right, Race and U.S.-Russia Relations. Before we are sort of stalling a tiny little bit because one of our panelists is running late, but we're going to get started now. I would say if this is your first time at the Jordan Center, we have a sign-up sheet on the outside of the door, so please sign up. You can leave your name so you can get more information about our events going on here. So without further ado, I'd like to turn this over to our organizer today, and she will be conducting the panel and moderating the discussion. We have until 2 o'clock today, so we're gonna have presentations from the panelists, and then we're gonna open it up to a larger discussion that Dr. Wilson will be moderating. So Dr. Jennifer Wilson is a postdoctoral fellow for academic diversity at the University of Pennsylvania in the Department of Slavic Languages and Literature. She's written about race in Russian society for The Guardian, the Los Angeles Review of Books, and for the Jordan Center's own All the Russias blog, which if you haven't checked out yet, is under the direction of Professor Hornstein, who does an amazing job with it, so check out All the Russias blog as well. She also runs the Translating Race in Eurasia Research Initiative. So I would like to thank Dr. Wilson for taking the initiative to organize this panel. I'd like to thank all of you for coming out here to talk about what I'm sure will be a fascinating discussion, and thank our panelists for joining us. Yeah. So I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Wilson. Great.
All right, and thank you, Josh, and the Jordan Center for agreeing to host this forum, and special thanks to Natasha, Terrell, who's not here yet, and Casey for lending their time today to talk about an important but surprisingly overlooked aspect of U.S.-Russia relations, which is the question of race. My motivation for organizing this event was a tendency I saw after Trump's victory on November 8th to explain his win as being due to one of two things. One being Russia's supposed interference in the process, either directly through hacking the DNC emails or indirectly by spreading misinformation. The other explanation we saw for Trump's victory was an underestimation of white angst, that is, an underestimation of racism's potency in American electoral politics. What was interesting to me was that these conversations, the conversation about Russia and the conversation about racism, were happening separately. And some commentators even suggested that to attribute Trump's victory to Russia was to downplay the role of race in the election. This, as someone who's thought a lot about race and racism in Russia over the years, struck me as a teachable moment. Yes, there is racial discourse in Russia, and it affects both its international and domestic politics. And Casey, Natasha, and Terrell are three people who've been writing about precisely that. So I'll introduce you. Terrell Starr is a senior reporter for FoxtrotAlpha, where he covers Russia and U.S. politics. His political reporting and commentary has appeared in the New York Times, Fusion, and the Daily Beast. He also frequently appears on MSNBC to discuss Russia and global racial politics. He was a 2009 and 2010 Fulbright Scholar based in Ukraine, where he researched Afro-Ukrainian identity among migrant communities in Kyiv. Casey Michelle has worked as a journalist in both the U.S. and the former Soviet Union. His work has appeared in Foreign Policy, The Atlantic, The New Republic, and Politico. He authored a report for People for the American Way that examined Russian cultivation of American white nationalists, religious fundamentalists, and domestic secessionists. And Natasha Bertrand is a reporter and editor at Business Insider, where she covers geopolitics, national security, and foreign policy. She has written for Business Insider about ties between the American alt-right movement and ultra-nationalist groups in Russia. Previously, she worked at a political think tank in Madrid, Spain, researching EU relations with the Middle East and Russia. So So since the three of them work on really different aspects of this relationship between the alt-right and Russia and the U.S., I'm going to interview them sort of individually, but you can each sort of jump in at any point, and then we're going to open it up for discussion. So I'm going to start with Natasha. Natasha, last December you wrote in a piece that, quote, the alt-right has found a natural ally in Russia's current zeitgeist. What do you mean by that? What is Russia's current zeitgeist, and what's made it appealing to white nationalist groups in the United States?
So I think the zeitgeist of at least from the top down among Kremlin officials ever since the start of Putin's third term especially has been this kind of, he's basically spearheaded this nationalist, ultra-conservative turn in Russia. He's done that largely by empowering the Russian Orthodox Church and using that in, you know, as a way to kind of drive his frankly oppressive legislation through, anti-gay, anti-abortion, things like that. So I think that combined with, you know, the kind of opposition to the West just broadly, and the increasing tension between Russia and the U.S. Has kind of positioned Russia as in direct opposition to the West, and especially in opposition to Western values like globalization, multiculturalism, liberalism. So in that sense, I think that white nationalists, especially in the U.S., see Putin as kind of a model of how the state can work in tandem with the church and like preserving traditional values, how the state can, you know, kind of place itself directly in opposition to globalization. So I think, you know, they see Russia as kind of this kind of beacon for nationalism, especially over the last 4 or so years.
Yeah, you mentioned globalization, and one of the reasons why the alt-right looks to Russia is they say that Russia is fighting this tendency towards globalism. Can you talk about sort of globalism and sort of what that term means and maybe how it's different from globalization, if it is?
I think that, you know, Putin especially has made himself a direct opponent of supranational organizations like the NATO and the EU, the UN. He thinks that it stands directly in contrast with nationalistic goals. He thinks that, you know, so that's something that he shares with nationalists in the U.S. That's something that they have in common. They think that self-determination is the most important thing, and that community constantly overrides individual rights, community, nation, etc. When you have organizations like the UN and, you know, things like that, especially NATO, trying to basically dictate what a country can and can't do, that makes them really nervous and uncomfortable. So I think that self-determination is at the center of the nationalist movement in the U.S., around the world, in Europe too, and then that's being, you know, translated by Russian. So.
I was really interested, you wrote about this conference that took place in 2015 in Russia in St. Petersburg that was organized by the ultra-nationalist group Rodina. And you were saying that certain members of the American alt-right movement attended. So can you tell us a bit more about that conference and sort of what brought the alt-right there and sort of who among the alt-right was present?
Yeah, so this conference got a lot of attention in the media. It was in March 2015, I think it was March, and it was the International Russian Conservative Forum, that's how it was billed. And I think it's also interesting that this whole nationalistic turn in Russia is being characterized as a conservative turn. But anyway, so it was basically a forum for extreme far-right fringe thinkers. It was kind of like a safe space for them to go and just rant against, you know, everything that the U.S. stands for, everything the West stands for, you know, the moral decay that is being spearheaded by things like globalization and, you know, immigration and multiculturalism.
Wasn't it hosted at a Holiday Inn?
Yes, it was hosted at a Holiday Inn. So you had these white supremacists from the U.S., Jared Taylor and Sam Dixon, who were invited to partake in this forum. And Jared Taylor is very extreme. He calls himself a race realist. He was the former director of the National Policy Institute, which now is led by Richard Spencer. It's a white supremacist think tank in Virginia. Even he called it like the fringe of the fringe. Even he was like surprised by how extreme this forum was. And then Sam Dixon was there, and he actually was an attorney at one point for the KKK. So, you know, he was there. He also is kind of in Richard Spencer's sphere. And yeah, I mean, out of that forum was birthed the World National Conservative Movement, something like that. And that's actually like, you know, they've tried to make it their mission to bring all of the fringe groups and far-right extremist groups from all over the world into this kind of sphere where it's kind of like, whereas the International Russia Conservative Forum, spearheaded by Rodina, is an ideas thing. The movement that they that came out of that is more based on action. So there's also like a paramilitary aspect to this movement that was birthed out of that meeting of these far right groups. There's a lot of activism on social media, etc., by that movement. So it's definitely growing.
Okay. Are they learning Russian, the people who attended this meeting? I mean, like, how is all this communication happening?
I don't know.
Okay.
I mean, it was people all over the world. It was European far right groups.
I've been called racial slurs in English during my travels in the Soviet Union. So you know, there's a possibility that that didn't happen.
I don't think anyone.
And so you mentioned the KKK, and maybe this is a question all of you could talk on, but what is the role of anti-Semitism here in creating this bridge between the alt-right in America and sort of ultra-nationalists in Russia?
So when I was interviewing this guy, Matthew Heimbach, he was dubbed like the new white nationalist to look for in 2016 or 2017 or whatever by like the Southern Poverty Law, I don't know. But he is just very, very extreme. And he, you know, throughout the entire interview was trying to convince me that he was not anti-Semitic. And that his idea of white nationalism does not necessarily mean white supremacy. That's something that is very common among most white nationalists. They try to stay away from the white supremacist rhetoric in order for their movement to have broader appeal. Jared Taylor, Richard Spencer, they're all trying to move away from the kind of neo-Nazi white supremacist kind of thing because they want to mainstream their movement. But in the same breath, Heimbach, he was like, oh, well, I'm not, you know, a white supremacist, but there's a global Jewish conspiracy to promote multiculturalism and, you know, just kind of open borders. So basically this idea that the Jewish, you know, global oligarchy is working towards global domination is at the center of all of these nationalists, well, the vast majority of their perceptions about why nationalism should be.
Yeah, I was just going to say, if anyone ever wants to have an interesting conversation with a white nationalist, I don't know if any of them are here today. Go ahead and ask them, because again, as Natasha was just talking about, it's nationalism through and through for these guys, right? Community over individual. But go ahead and ask them about how they feel about nationalism within the post-Soviet space. So about Kazakh nationalism, right? Or Ukrainian nationalism. I was interviewing Heimbach last year, and I asked him about this. And instead of saying, well, of course we support nationalists, no matter their, you know, stripe, creed, color, whatever, he says, well, actually, President Poroshenko is Jewish, and it's all part of the Jewish conspiracy. So it's a nice out for them, I guess. But it's a fun way to trip them up if you guys ever get a chance.
The contradictions, yeah.
Yeah, plenty of irony.
So in terms of how that relates to Russia, I mean, anti-Semitism in Russia was pretty rampant up until the late 90s, early 2000s, to the point where, I mean, I think it was in 2001, there were, you know, it became such a concern in the U.S. that 98 U.S. senators wrote a letter, an open letter to Putin, expressing their concern over the rampant anti-Semitism that was happening in Russia. So it's waned a lot since then, but anti-Semitism is still like a central platform of nationalists there. So,
and speaking of religion, you mentioned in your article in December that there are now alt-right Americans who are converting to Russian Orthodoxy. Can you say more about that? Why would Russian Orthodoxy be appealing to the American alt-right?
So this is something that Casey could speak probably better than me to. But I think that they see, and I touched upon this briefly earlier, they see the Russian Orthodox Church, that their its relationship with the Kremlin as kind of a model for how they would like to see the church and state working together. So it's not the Russian Orthodox Church isn't necessarily, it's not racialized. And actually, when Heimbach told me that he had converted to Russian Orthodoxy, that was actually, I mean, members of the Russian Orthodox Church reached out to me and said that's categorically false. There was no one in the Russian Orthodox Church that accepted him into the church because we reject outright racism and, you know, things that he espouses. So I think that it's just kind of a way for them to, you know, it's just kind of a model for them of a way that, you know, traditional values can be placed at the center of politics. So.
Well, yeah, I mean, to Natasha's point, it's less a dogmatic or theocratic appeal. I mean, it's not as if they see the ceremonies on Sundays and say, I like XYZ aspect, therefore I'm going to convert. It's less so that, it's more so the relationship that the Russian Orthodox Church, especially in Russia, maintains with the Kremlin, and the marriage of church and state, and dissolving the difference between the two, playing into autocratic support, playing into the primacy of the executive, and of the marriage of state and religion.
Now, it seems like this collaboration sort of started in 2013 with the gay propaganda laws in Russia. You write about how there were members of the American alt-right who were actually sending support, or I don't know if that was monetary or what, to groups in Russia who were advocating for the passage of that law. Mm-hmm. Is that the case?
Yeah, so actually American social conservatives have been basically trying to find an audience in Russia since right after the fall of the Soviet Union. So abortion was legal throughout the Soviet Union, and afterwards I think that American, these really far-right religious groups in the U.S. Started to export their ideology to Russia. They thought they'd find maybe a receptive audience there. So. The anti-abortion stuff that began in the 90s, where the American groups started to have more influence there, and then it just kind of kept going with the World Congress of Families. That was an organization that was created in I think 2005, but it was created in Russia, and it was basically a way for this global kind of like Christian community could lobby for more religious legislation to go through. So they basically set up this organization of far-right groups in Russia in 2013, and those organizations inside Russia on behalf of the WCF, the World Congress of Families, started to push through this gay propaganda law, which is basically makes it illegal for anyone to even talk about anything related to homosexuality in front of minors. Mm-hmm.
Do you see that as laying the groundwork for what's happening now on the level of race in terms of how these groups are organizing? Is that the catalyst for this kind of union?
I think it started earlier. Okay. I think it's been going on since well before 2013, but I mean, what do you guys think?
Terrell, did you want to jump in?
No, I was going to say it definitely started well before then. I think it even started even during the Soviet period. Yeah. So. One of the things that when I first talk about race in Russia with anyone is I start off with how the Soviets actually reached out to African countries during the late 1950s when the continent was decolonizing. And so the idea was a geopolitical war, which is to infuse the continent with educational opportunities so that these people would study in Moscow, then return to the continent of Africa. And so the propaganda machine behind that actually went into full swing during the 50s, but it actually began during the 20s. It started off with black people studying at Tuskegee Institute who wanted to be, agricultural engineers, but for various reasons could not find jobs, but were actually recruited to go to Russia and different parts of the Soviet Union, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, for example, cotton curation. Those things, very small numbers, but enough where there are enough records on it to really document what the black people's experiences were there. Black people had problems from the start. The main issue is because they were intended to be showpieces, not to be full-time members of society. And this is not only with black people. You can even talk about caucus people from the Caucasus. I lived in Georgia for more than 2.5 years. And the word chornony, many Georgian people told me that, you know what, we're both black. And it took me, coming from, one of the lessons that you gain from that is that living in this in the Soviet former Soviet space for 4 years as a black person, grew up in the inner city of Detroit, you start to understand what the definition of what white means outside of the American context. In the Soviet context, white, which is the supremacist dominant racial figure, is a Slav, and they're Russian. Anyone else who is not Russian gets a lower, gets on a lower tier. And the first people who can give you that as an example are Ukrainians. And people are surprised. Well, you know what? Ukrainians and Russians, aren't they the same people? I said no. And moreover, if you look at it from a wider European context, and I'm going back to the larger question here, as I think it deserves some explaining. Ukrainians and Polish people, let's be blunt about it, they're perceived as white trash. I mean, I know it sounds harsh, but that's what it is. You know, within the larger European context, and Caucasian people are in that same realm. And a Caucasian person, a Georgian person told me, you know, Terrell, I never liked the Soviet Union because throughout our education system, we were always taught that we were kind of like the lower end of the racial totem pole. And so the larger Soviet experiment, in my mind, was never able to overcome its Slavicness. So this conversation that we're having about how racialized and how Russians divide race, it was very much in parallel with America, and it's a different history, but it has a similar strain. And so I bring it back to America is that right now what we're experiencing is that America is struggling to deal and overcome its whiteness. Okay, and so with Trump, when I talk about him, and I covered the campaign last year as a senior correspondent, with people who support Trump, it has nothing to do with America because the genesis of his campaign dealt with patriotism, right? Defense of state, defense of nation, security. And if that were the case, don't you think that his supporters would be highly upset with him dissing the national security agencies, 17 security agencies are telling you essentially that Russia hacked the election, you're saying no, that's not true. Insulting veterans, for example, right? So I wrote a piece in the Washington Post that pretty much argued that Trump supporters did not vote for him to protect American sovereignty. They did it to protect their whiteness because they feel like it's being devalued. Yeah. And so there, and I've experienced similar conversations with people who travel to Russia. Because in America we have it's Mexicans, and Russia is it's people from Central Asia, it's people from the North and South Caucasus. And if you do not, and even to a certain, and as far as Ukraine goes, which is where I've studied primarily, you have to, that they were the people who started off what we call with alternative facts. And one example is the famine in Ukraine. If you go, there's a memorial in Ukraine that's near the Arsenal metro station in Kyiv. You go to it, there are thousands of documents that you can read where high-ranking officials specifically said, we need to take this food from, from certain parts of Ukraine so these people can starve. Like, it's there, right? And what does Russia do? Like Trump? That's not true.
Never happened.
Yeah. Even though there are thousands of documents in Ukrainian and Russian speaking to the contrary. And so this, what's that?
I was gonna say, it's like the Bowling Green Massacre, right?
Yeah, it
that happened.
So the larger issue with both of these countries, and if we're thinking about the confluence of Russian politics and Putin, and I'm saying Trump, not Putin, Trump coming together, is that you're both dealing with people who are harnessing the full strength of their country's respective supremacy. Russian supremacy, American white supremacy. They have the same objectives, different histories, with the same goals of alienating people who are not themselves.
Casey, do you want to
jump in? I think Terrell is getting right to the crux of the appeal that Putin has for the white nationalists here in the U.S. And mm-hmm. Tosh, maybe this rings true for you as well, in that they view him as a vehicle for or a model for restoration of a certain type of supremacy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Within Russia, it is ethnic Russian supremacy. In the U.S., it is white supremacy. Whatever white may mean in the U.S. at that time, because as we well know, the definition of whiteness in America has expanded significantly over the last two centuries. Italians, Bulgarians, those from the Balkans, Irish.
They were able to integrate into whiteness here in America, right?
Right.
So I think the next, going into that, who can integrate into whiteness within the Russian context?
Yeah.
Right, so I think that's the larger, I think that's the larger issue, because to a certain extent, like, Ukrainians really couldn't do it. Baltic people really couldn't do it. So you talk about the Jew, you know, the question about Jewish issues, right? So one of the things that the Soviets did during the purge, I think as everyone here knows, there's a period under Stalin, who was a Georgian, by the way, there are several purges that completely wiped out Jewish people, right? And so there's this book that I like by, it's called Bloodlands. It's Bloodlands, and there are several others that discuss this. But basically, one of the reasons why Stalin was so adamant of knocking out Jewish people, it fits into an age-old stereotype, is that they're taking our resources, right? And so, but it's not only just falls within Russia, so it goes across the entire Soviet space. So I was in Ukraine one time, and there are two instances where I ran into, there is a word that starts with a zhi, which I will not say, which is a very derogatory term for Jewish people in the car. And I know the word yevrei, like I know the proper term of it. And the guy was talking about Arseniy Yatsenyuk. This is during the 2010 election. He said, you know, you pay attention to our elections. I said, yes. And he said, well, you know what? Yulia is a Jew. Yatsenyuk is a Jew. Like, we have all these Jews that are running for our campaigns. And like, and he really believed it. And I ran into another person, a group of people, students, who, after watching Do the Right Thing at their American embassy, this is a true story. I know it sounds funny. It's a true story. Watching Do the Right Thing at the American Embassy, was about 50 students there. They did a great job of analyzing it. They spoke excellent English. And after this film showing, we walked outside and we talked. And the first thing they said, you know what, Terrell? We don't have a problem with you. We like you. Black people are cool. We hate Jews. The puzzle that I have on my face right now, I just did not know what to say to them, because I dealt with my own issue. Like, I dealt with my own issues of being a black person, being stopped by the police in Ukraine multiple times each week. But I had an extreme experience of people saying that we're fine with black people, we just don't like Jewish people. And they broke it down. It comes down to the same thing that happens here in America and happened in Russia, which is they're taking our resources. Absolutely. And they had their own alternative facts. And that's what we're, you know, because they gave me their history of it by saying that, you know what, the first thing they try to take from Ukrainians are our banks.
Yeah.
You know, and they said, and she was very passionately talking about, oh, and we try to talk to these people, but they won't listen. And it really sounded like she was on the verge of suggesting violence. And that's what really bothered me about it. And so I'm saying that this, you know, it's happening in Russia, but across the Soviet space, particularly the Slavic spaces, this issue does occur. And in Ukraine, that's dealing with its own racial and identity issues, one of the things that is confronting is what it is to be a Ukrainian, because so much of it was forced to be tied to Russia, right? And so there are similar strains that are happening in that.
So this conversation about anti-Semitism brings me to a question I have for Casey, which is about Alexander Dugin, who's a really important figure. So I'm going to ask you later about Richard Spencer, the creator of the term alt-right, and his Russian wife, Nina Kuprianova, who I believe got her PhD in Russian history and wrote her dissertation, I understand, on Alexander Dugin. So can you talk a bit about Dugin, why his work is so important for the alt-right?
Sure. Does anyone here know who Alexander Dugin is? Are they familiar with his name?
I don't know.
Okay, so he's relatively well-known in certain circles, especially Russian studies circles. But Dugin is Where to start? He considers himself a political philosopher, a geopolitical philosopher. He is a neo-fascist. He first made a name for himself back in the 90s, the ultra-right in Russia, working at far-right newspapers. He's very well known within the far-right fascist circles. Some of you may have seen pictures of him. He has a great big bushy beard. Not as nice as Terrell, a lot more shaggy. But he kind of made it over, in the transatlantic media. American media first began covering him a couple years ago, when everything in Ukraine, when the Ukrainian crisis first burst. He was a professor of sociology at a university in Moscow, and was it June, July of 2014? He took to Facebook and called for what many interpreted to be genocide against Ukrainians, and he was fired from his position. Since then, he has acted as something of an unofficial surrogate for the Kremlin, especially as it pertains to constructing links in the West with European and American far-right individuals. He has his own television show, he speaks English. If anyone wants any kind of entertaining videos, I would recommend going to YouTube and typing in Dugin in English. You know, you can tell he's reading from a teleprompter, so it's fun to watch. He has certain terms there. He refers to Hillary Clinton as the saxophonist's wife, so he tells about him. But he is well-known within academic circles for his work on the geopolitical concept of Eurasianism, which is a concept that grew in the 1920s following the Russian Civil War. Members of the Whites relocated to Central Europe and formulated this idea of Russia as this conservative bulwark, a global conservative bulwark, against a libertine and weak-willed and progressive West. Dugin took this theory, re-updated it for a new generation of thinkers, academics, people at NYU panels reintroduce Russia as a far-right conservative bulwark. And it is around this theoretical pole that he has helped construct that this constellation of American white nationalists, alt-right figures, have begun condensing. So that's kind of a broad overview of Dugin. If anyone wants a fantastic read on him, I'd recommend Charles Clover's Black Wind, White Snow. Clover was the Financial Times bureau chief in Moscow and has a wonderful book on Eurasianism and Dugin.
It's also disputed how much he has Putin's ear.
Yes,
right?
Yes,
so
it is.
What's your perception?
It's easy, and it happens all the time, to overinflate and overhype Dugin's influence in the Kremlin. He is not Putin's brain. He is not Putin's Rasputin, no matter how much he tries to dress up.
Right.
He needs better beard care. That said, his book, one of his most famous book, is called The Fourth Political Theory. Again, posits Russia as said it once, I've said it 1,000 times, conservative bulwark. Globally, it's still assigned to every member of the Russian General Staff Academy, as well as other military academies. That said, again, he doesn't have Putin's ear. There's only evidence they've met once, maybe twice. Nobody really knows any details of that meeting, or those few meetings. But he does play a role in constructing these transatlantic far-right networks. So, just to cite a few examples,
Yeah.
In 2014, Richard Spencer, who we'll talk about more, I guess, in a second, tried to host a far-right conference in Budapest, invited Dugin to be one of the keynote speakers. Dugin at that time was already under sanctions, so he couldn't attend, unfortunately. Spencer is married to a woman named Nina Kuprianova. There wasn't a dissertation that she wrote on Dugin, but she has translated his work into English for English speakers. As one of my editors called them, a white power couple.
Okay.
So that's a nice.
Could you say a bit more about them, like remind our audience who Richard Spencer and Nina Kuprianova?
Sure. Has anyone seen a video of a white nationalist getting punched in the face over the last few weeks? Well, that's Richard Spencer. So he is probably the most prominent face of white nationalists in the U.S. right now. He first kind of gained notoriety in 2016. He runs the National Policy Institute, which is based out of Virginia, splits his time between Virginia and Montana. He's not a member of a Nazi party, so technically he's not a neo-Nazi. He is a fascist. He desires the creation of a white ethno-state somewhere in the U.S. He hasn't specified where. I have family in Montana, so hopefully not there. He then gained national notoriety after the election because he led a celebration party that the Atlantic got video of, where he has his drink and he has 200 people in the audience. He says, "Hail Trump! Hail our people! Hail victory!" And
he threw up the salute,
and a lot of people responded with the Nazi salute.
Did you see that? There is actually Roland Martin, who has the only black news television programs. CNN, yeah. And it's actually on BET. It's actually on TV One.
Oh, TV One. Okay. Yeah.
It's TV One, and he spent he gave that man an hour. And he's actually trending, and he actually tore into him. So if you just want to see him completely debunked, like, that was one of the few shows to see that. And I was actually surprised he would talk to a black person. Yeah. But I haven't seen him talk to a black journalist since. Because he was completely he was completely debunked. So if you want to see that, just type in Roland Martin and Spencer, and you'll see that.
So Dugan remains under... Oh, sorry, just to go back to Spencer.
Yeah.
So he tried to have Dugan as the keynote speaker at this 2014 conference. Spencer, again, is married to Kuprianova, who in her spare time translates Dugan's work into English. Kuprianova also has... She goes by a few different names. Nina Byzantina, Nina Spencer. If anyone's on Twitter, you've probably seen her defending Kremlin policy to the end. She's not a bot. She's a troll, but she's a very...
She calls herself a Kremlin troll leader.
Yeah,
Her Twitter bio is that.
The thing I would say that separates her from the rest of the kind of morass on Twitter, and there's a lot of it, is that she is fluent in English. She's able to use turns of phrase, English lexicon, American lexicon, English diction, sarcasm, irony, to gain a relatively substantial following online. So that's the two of them.
Yeah. You were saying that some of Spencer's followers take issue with the fact that Kuprianova is half Georgian.
Yeah.
So how aware is the alt-right of these kinds of sort of ethnic distinctions within Russia? Like, do they have opinions about the Tatars and Chechens things of that?
I wouldn't say they're the most well-read bunch. But I think this actually gets to the point Terrell was just making, in this conception of whiteness as it pertains to Russia and the former Soviet Union, as it pertains to the U.S. So Spencer's married to Kuprianova. She's part Georgian. She considers herself, as far as I'm aware, white. Spencer, I can only presume, considers his wife white as well. I don't think he would marry someone who's non-white. who knows?
I think that they've actually separated.
Oh yeah, sorry, they have separated.
But recently, October.
Yeah, right.
Crazy
kids
could
make it.
Yeah.
White power couple.
So he has been, Spencer's been criticized relatively heavily within the white nationalist community by most especially a guy named Greg Johnson, who's a Southern nationalist, and he does not consider Kuprianova white because she is part Georgian. And he says, and he doesn't consider Georgians white, doesn't consider Armenians white, doesn't consider certainly Azeris white. The Caucasus are this fascinating fault line within concepts of whiteness, both within the former Soviet Union and here in the U.S. There's another guy. Does anyone know the name Mike Cernovich? Does that mean anything to anyone? So he was, again, a member of the alt-right. The New Yorker called him the meme mastermind of the alt-right. And he's, again, I wouldn't say he's very well-read, but he's there and has a very substantial following. He actually doesn't consider Russians white. So, you know, you have this you know, race is fluid, race doesn't have any fixed definitions, and you certainly see that come to play.
I mean, but, you know, on that note, and to entertain this craziness to a certain extent, it's other thinking. In America, Russians were not considered a part of the traditional white class. You know, so I think that's something to keep in mind. I mean, they integrated to eventually become white, right? But they were not particularly welcome along. You know, like you could say the same thing for the Irish, same thing for Jewish people, Italians, absolutely, yeah. So within that kind of crazy, you know, that framework, it could possibly, kind of, you know, work,
It doesn't exist in a vacuum. You can trace it back.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So Casey, a lot of your work recently has focused on Russia's support for secessionist movements in the U.S., like sort of the Texan and Alaskan secessionist movements, which are driven, at least in part, by racism and xenophobia. So why do these groups see Russia and Russian kind of alt ultra-nationalist groups as an ally?
Has anyone been to Texas? Anyone? Yeah. All right, so I went to school down in Texas. I lived there for a while.
Been several times, by the way.
Oh, yeah. So that's kind of where my initial interest in this came from. In 2015, there's a group called the Anti-Globalization Movement of Russia. And if I forget anything, Natasha's also an expert on this, so ask her. It's run by a guy named Alexander Yonov, who's 26 years old. He's 7 feet tall. He's a very colorful character. Very well-dressed guy, too. They organized a conference, again, in 2015, that had a whole host of Western secessionists come to Moscow from Texas and Hawaii and Puerto Rico. There were some black nationalists who actually showed up as well. This is already after the St. Petersburg conference that Natasha was talking about earlier that had white nationalists present. It was a meeting of the minds. It was a networking opportunity. No one really paid much attention to it. You know, it's a bunch of fringe guys off in the middle of nowhere, you know, doing whatever it is secessionists may do. In 2016, the Kremlin took interest and funded another, well, funded in part, another conference. And this one had individuals from Texas and from, this time, California. So some of you may have seen over the news, you know, in the news the past few months, there's been certain momentum about a California secession movement called Cal Exit, which is a mouthful, but, you know,
yeah.
It's a hashtag. The gentleman leading it, who Natasha's interviewed, so you can tell him, who's this guy? No, he never responded to my interview request.
Yeah, his name is Louis Marinelli. He is the leader of Yes California, which is a separatist movement, and I actually started getting interested in him because I realized that the first embassy that he set up was in Moscow. So I didn't understand that. I didn't understand why a California separatist movement would have its first, you know, foreign headquarters in Moscow. And so I reached out to him, and he told me, look, we're just trying, basically he said that they're trying to cultivate countries that they know will stand up to the U.S. Because they are trying to get support for these kinds of, for their separatist movement, and they see that Russia is generally supportive of anything that might fracture their adversaries. So,
what I have a question for you. So, just what is their main motive? I mean, it has to be more than they just want to kind of separate. So, what? Why do they want to separate? What is it about America that they find so abominable that they no longer want to be a part of it?
I was a member of the a California separatist who's been that way pretty much his entire life. He emailed me and he was like, you completely, you know, kind of glossed over all of the historical, you know, the historical narrative about a separatist California and like how deep this goes, really. And, you know, I didn't really do that much research on the in-depth thinking behind the separatist movement in California. But if I had to, what do you think?
No, I mean, I think to Terrell's question, the reason and rationale behind the secession movements in Texas and California is political, right? It is that those in Texas don't enjoy living under a Democratic administration, and those in California, as we saw with the recent vote tallies, are not enthused with the Trump presidency. So I think that is kind of one of the primary driving factors behind support for these two secession movements. Texas obviously has a far deeper history of secession in the U.S. and a far broader base of support in the state than California.
What's interesting though is that when I interviewed Marinelli, he didn't really make a big show out of politicizing his movement. He didn't really criticize Trump. He wasn't super.
He voted for Trump.
He did. He was actually a Bernie supporter.
Yeah.
And then he
went for Trump. He's just to kind of construct another bridge there. Marinelli now kind of plays himself as this far left character, or at least leftist progressive character. He used to work with the National Organization for Marriage, some of you may be familiar with, a vehemently anti-gay organization. He was the social media coordinator, editor on that or something. So he's had, as he says, a come to Jesus moment as it pertains to politics. But he's in Moscow opening up a rent-free embassy if anyone ever wants to visit. He still lives in Russia.
That takes me to my next question. So you wrote a piece for the Daily Beast called How Putin Played the Far Left. So most of what we're talking about here today is the alt-right, but you make the case in that piece that the ultra-left ended up engaging in a lot of rhetoric that was very similar to the rhetoric espoused by the alt-right when it came into Russia, when it came to Russia, and ended up sort of becoming apologists for racism and neo-Nazis in Russia. Could you kind of summarize that article and your argument?
Yeah, sure. Perfectly understandably, over the last few months, much of the focus, both within academia as well as in the media, has been on Russia's relationship with the far right, especially here in the U.S. That's fine and good, and I'm very happy, and it helps me pay the bills, which I appreciate very much. To cover that, but there was not a commensurate focus, at least what I found when I was writing this, on Russia's relationship and Russia's attempted cultivation therein of far-left actors in the U.S. and the West. 2 years ago, I was at Columbia. I had the opportunity to participate in a program or in a class where we monitored RT, Russia Today, the Russian, which is a wonderful example of 21st century state propaganda. One of the kind of primary findings we found up there, and this was at the Columbia Journalism School, everything's still online if if anyone wants me to send out our findings, I'd be happy to. It was that they targeted a far left and nominally progressive individuals, movements, and actors. And we really saw this take shape in 2016 via the Jill Stein Green Party campaign. Some of you may have seen a clip or a photo of December 2015. There was a 10-year anniversary gala in RT's honor. Jill Stein was invited to this gala. There's a photo of her sitting at the table with President Putin, wining and dining, clapping and shaking hands. Lieutenant General Michael Flynn, who is now Trump's national security advisor, was also there, which is perhaps even more concerning. No one knows who paid for Stein's travel over there. She hasn't responded to any of my questions about that. No one knows who funded that trip. RT also had the Green Party debate and had her on multiple times to offer her own commentary. The primary area of overlap, again, is within foreign policy. So Green Party, a nominally progressive foreign policy, their platform, it dovetails completely with Russia's foreign policy. And that stems from anti-Americanism, anti-imperialism, or at least theoretical anti-imperialism, because they have no problem with Russian expansionism in places like Crimea or Ukraine or Georgia, throughout the post-Soviet space. Her vice president, a gentleman named Baraka, Ajmal Baraka?
Yeah, Baraka.
He has gone so far as to say that the downing of flight MH17 over Ukraine in 2014, he has said on record that that was a false flag attack and designed to discredit Russia. So this is, and Stein put him on the ticket. So it didn't get a lot of play. Again, she's a third-party candidate. It was, she didn't win any electoral votes. The margin of her victory, or her vote tally, was comparable to the margins of difference in states like Michigan and Wisconsin and Pennsylvania. The cultivation is there.
So let's move to Terrell. Terrell, you spent a year living in Kyiv as a Fulbright Scholar.
Year and a half, so.
Year and a half. Can you tell us about your research project there?
Yeah, so basically I focused on how black people, black female Ukrainians, felt like they were integrating into Ukrainian society. And this particular work of mine, which is still ongoing, Ukraine during that time was going through some significant political changes. That was a year when Viktor Yushchenko was elected to office. He was the orange, he came off the Orange Revolution, be victorious, and he was a candidate who initially with Yulia Tymoshenko, prime minister, they eventually fell out and they split into different parties, that they were going to lead Ukraine first to a European Union neighborhood agreement that would be like a long road to EU membership and eventually NATO. And that actually did not work out for a wide range of complex reasons. But during this time, what I found is that generally, when you cover Russia and Eastern European studies, I find that many of the angles and outlooks that address the political problems, they either ignore, either they don't spend a lot of time on race, or they don't spend a lot of time on minorities within these particular countries and how they view themselves as Ukrainians. And during my time there, what I learned was that many of the black Ukrainians who I interviewed, several dozens of them, hundreds of them over the country, is that many of them had a very negative view of Yushchenko. And the reason being was that they felt he was very nationalist. And they felt that he was someone who was completely trying to just wipe out the Russian aspects of their own identities, right? Because many of these people spoke Russian, and many of the people who I interviewed felt like he was someone who did not want to have a nuanced conversation about what it means to be Russian, what it meant to include people who are not typical Slavic Ukrainians. And so what that led me to do was to expand my conversation, my own outlook on what does it mean for a country to rebuild itself, right? Once it, because essentially that's what's happening right now. So when you're wrestling yourself out of the Russian sphere of influence, right, you're dealing with the eastern part of Ukraine, which dealt with decades of a population redistribution. You're dealing with a political ideology where you had Poland to your west for a while, and so you're crunched between these two, you know, powers that were and powers that are. And so where's room left for you? And when I break it down to American audiences, particularly people who don't study this region, I just say, imagine the fact that we are here in America and we have waters that are to our left and to our right. And we have Canada up north and we have Mexico down south. Generally, you don't consider those people as being hostile actors, right? And so, whereas in Europe, there was a conflict pretty much everywhere around them. And so, going back to my project, many of the women I spoke to, and they're mostly black women, and the reason behind that was that it was harder to get men to talk to me. And the men I found, I don't know if it was their pride, because what I was looking for was people to tell me how their situations really were, right? And so sometimes these people married outside, you know, I guess outside of their race. So let's say if a black woman is married to like a typical, like a Ukrainian guy, what does that Ukrainian man's mom think about bringing this black woman to her home? And so a lot of times the men would not be willing to tell me that. Now the women, on the other hand, would give me everything. I mean, they went into sharp details and pretty much told me that their family lives were basically, they lost family members as a result of their interracial marriages to these mixed race people. And so, so I'm bringing all this up to say that within my study of Ukraine, I go down to not only the racial dynamics of Slavic Ukrainians dealing with Russia, I deal with how people like mixed race people feel like they're being brought on as Ukraine is designing itself into a multicultural state. And it was based on what I continue to find, because I was just in Ukraine a month ago. It's an extremely painful process that many of them feel like they're being left out of.
So in 2015, you wrote a piece for the Washington Post about your time there, and quote, "What being a black man in Ukraine showed me about race relations in the U.S. So what did you mean about that? What did Ukraine teach you about race relations here? And did that influence how you understood the racial dynamics of this most recent presidential election?
It did, because it gave me some experience, because I spent a lot of time interviewing black Donald Trump supporters. Which is another thing, and it ties into this. And so going back to Ukraine, I stopped counting the number of times I was stopped by cops at 30. And they go, and being here, being a black man here in New York City, there's always this fear of being stopped or stopped and frisked by cops. There's not a day that goes by when I don't think about that. And I think that most black men or black people, period, or if you're a Latino, you see a cop, you have that thought going through your mind. And so I experienced it hard on when I was in Ukraine, primarily because people thought that I was an African immigrant who they could bribe money out of. And that's what I was later told. And I was in the African, and one of the issues too is that because you don't have a lot of black people going into these programs, you don't have people from the previous class to kind of give you tips on how to make it. So you have to learn on your own, more or less. So, and this was back in 2008, 2009, before Twitter became a thing, a real thing, right? So I was just kind of learning as I went along. And the Africans told me to never speak English, never to speak Russian to the police officers. So I was stopped going to the Russian class one day by an officer, and he said in Russian, the first words that came out of his mouth once he told me to go into the back room, he looked into my eyes. First words, he said, "I know that you're a nigger and you're bringing drugs into our country, so you need to give me your drugs right now." And they kept me for 30 minutes trying to search for, you know, drugs, and which I did not have, of course. And so it was something that continued to happen. But what I found interesting was that I felt less fear with them because they primarily, all they wanted was money. Yeah. I didn't, you know, like it was, I never felt worried. Here in New York, I'm scared. Ukrainian cops, you just give them some money, you know, straf or whatever you call it, like they'll just, you know, they'll leave you alone. And I've done it. So that was the main difference that I found. And so going back into how I view race here, it really told me, it goes back to the issue of supremacy, because I actually stopped one cop and I asked the cop in Ukraine, I said, why are you stopping me? And I was with another guy. I said, well, why are you stopping me? You know, like, what cause do you have to stop me? And he's like, no, we're just searching. We do it to everybody. I said, really? I don't see, you know, I'm all, because I feel like I'm stopped every week. And the cop says, well, you know, we just want to make sure that drugs are off the streets. I'm like, how do you know that I'm selling, like, what makes you think that I'm selling drugs? Like, why would I come to Ukraine to sling rocks? I mean, why? You know, and like, he couldn't, and he, like he, I mean, seriously, like, I mean, and the guy couldn't think about it. And so, and I think the larger point is that the, like, I think he even kind of had to admit that it was absurd. Okay, and so with, when I approach race here, it taught me that regardless of, and I actually had to give that cop some credit, because, you know, I think in some instances the cop felt like he was doing his job. And what I later learned was that they have a racket of bribes that they have to get every week. And I know this because a police officer told me that he did it and went into intricate detail about how he bribed people. And he told me that it goes up the chain. You know, if you're a major, if you're a captain, if you're a lieutenant, like he went into very strong detail about $100 that starts with a cop that goes all the way up to a top commander in their district. And he said that you're just a part of that casualty, but you're easier because you're black. He just told me, you know, which I appreciated because he was honest with me. But, you know, when I cover race here, I cover it. A lot of people don't cover the conflict in Ukraine from a racial perspective, or talk about race, Russia as having a, as Russia's conflicts being racialized. And I think they very much are. And as I stated earlier, people, when I talk to people here about Ukraine and Georgia, my friends, they normally say, aren't these just a bunch of white people fighting each other? Like, that's how you really, that's the general conversation, because they don't know, right? Because here in America, if you see a Georgian, if you see a Ukrainian, if you see a Polish person, you think within our context, they fit in as being white. And I have to explain to them that these people have been, you know, that these different regions and these ethnic groups, whether they were kingdoms or whether they were lifetimes, whatever, have been fighting each other for hundreds and, you know, of years. And so it really helped me to break down how to cover international news so that Americans can actually read it. Because that's one of the challenges right now. How do you get people plugged in and informed on it? And I point to examples of race in Ukraine, in Russia, or in Georgia, break down how Georgian people or people from the Caucasus consider themselves to be black. That's what brings them in. Yeah. And so it helped me to cover, you know, to do a better job of covering this area.
So we're talking mostly about Trump today, but I want to actually take the conversation back to Obama. So when Obama called for sanctions against Russia, pro-Russian forces in Ukraine began disseminating this anti-Obama propaganda that was often articulated in racial terms, right? You know, Obama as a monkey with a banana. You know, how did that, when you saw that imagery popping up across Ukraine, what came to your mind? How did you process it?
It happened. Well, you know, the thing is that they've done it with other groups, right? I mean, they've done it with Georgians. They've done it with, you know, with even with, and I know Shaakashvili is his own little character, but I mean, he really is. I don't know if anyone is familiar with him or seen him speak, and even in English or Georgian, he's a character, right? But even the work, even the some of the images that were depicted about him during 2008 were very much racialized because it went into the Georgian, you know, about the dumb Georgian, the dumb, angry Georgian. That was a stereotype for Georgian, dumb and angry, right? So, you know, another thing too is that there is a strong irony about a black man from the south side of Chicago taking the strongest stance against Russia since the fall of the Soviet Union. Think about that. We ran against, you know, because this is not the first time that a sanctions regime was levied against Russia. It occurred during the 1990s because of Russia's involvement with Iran, with this nuclear program. There were some slight sanctions from the George Bush administration over the invasion of Georgia. But there was nothing as remotely robust and damaging to Russia's economy as the economic sanctions, particularly against the drilling, particularly against oil drilling, which Russia desperately needs because half of its GDP depends on energy. And so when I look at the racial aspect of it, I think it was further buoyed by the fact that they're like, how can I say this? I know exactly what I want to say, but I'm just thinking about the appropriate way to say it. You know, there's a vernacular in kind of like black talk. It's like, oh, this Negro didn't, right? Like, so within the truncated case of Trump, of Obama, I think that, like, what I think was really pushing the racism, like, no, this N-word did not do this to us. Because, I mean, the reality is that those sanctions hurt.
Yeah.
No, you know, regardless, in Ukraine, I I'm speaking with different members of parliament, government officials, and they're all, you know, calling for Obama. They say he's too weak. And I said, well, you know what? You can say that, but there was a Republican in office who did not, you know, strike hard against Georgia, right? And so they were, but the thing with Ukraine was the sanctions hurt them to a point where their GDP contracted in 2005 by 3.7%. That is a lot. And so what did I think? I think that they saw not only their economy hurt, but the fact that a black person did it to them, it just made it much worse. Because we have not seen anyone, and actually it was Obama who actually led the coalition, him through Joe Biden. Maybe there are a lot of politicians in Brussels who would hate to say that, who would hate to admit to that, but it was Obama who really pushed it. So I think that had a whole, I think his race and the fact that he really stuck them in their pockets really, really hurt, particularly with drilling, because ExxonMobil lost $1 billion as a result of those sanctions, as a result of the sanctions being enacted. And he actually enforced the National Security, I think it's called the National Defense Act, which allows for $150 million to in defensive lethal aid to go to Ukraine. So even though he did not advocate for lethal aid to be sent to Ukraine before he left, he did sign off at least on $350 million in defensive legal aid, which are basically tank destroyers, for example, to go there. So he stuck it to them. And I think the fact that he was black, I think that made it a lot worse.
Yeah. So I have more questions, but I want to make sure that we have time for questions from the audience. I think we have about 22 minutes left. So open up. Yes?
So I had some questions regarding race, mostly for Terrell, because I read your article a couple years ago.
Yeah.
But for the panel as a whole, so I lived in Russia last summer. I was doing the critical language scholarship, so it comes out of the same pot of money as the Fulbright.
Which one?
The critical language scholarship. It's with the State Department as well.
Oh, I got that one. Yeah.
So
great. I'm just happy that you got it. Right on.
Yeah,
I'm happy.
I appreciate that.
I hope you stay. Are you going? I'm sorry. I was going to ask you if you're going to stay with the Russian program. Answer your question. I'm just happy.
Okay. So as a black person. You know, I was one of two people in my group that went to Russia, and I was searching all over Google for people's experiences in the former Soviet Union that were black. I had previously traveled to Kazakhstan. I lived in Kazakhstan in 2014.
Where did you live in Kazakhstan?
I lived in Almaty.
Yeah.
The old capital, but it's a big city. Mm-hmm. My experiences regarding race there was kind of like a primer before going to Russia, because Kazakhstan is Asian, but they're Russian-speaking people, and they also really try hard to identify with Russians when compared to the other former Soviet countries. So I had to say that my experience in Russia regarding race were more positive.
Good.
I'd have to say that it seems to me that a lot of the rampant racism that was going on in Russia, not just towards blacks, I would say mostly towards Central Asians, who are considered black, the word shortening, has improved. But I just want to ask you, like, when you were called nigger, right? Because I went to Moscow, I was called nigger there, along with the other black student that was in my group. And in Russia, maybe perhaps in the former Soviet Union, that word nigger means black, but it's not racist. I don't want to challenge you or anything, but for many Russians, when they use that word nigger, it just means black person. Or that's how I understood it. So when I was called nigger, my classmate had a similar experience as you. He was just like, dude, that guy just called me a nigger. And I was just like, nah, man. I think he just meant to say nigger, and he was asking this guy, these two guys are asking to take pictures with us. I always get these requests in Russian context.
I get you.
So what I wanted to ask you, because I didn't want to make the whole question about me, but I wanted to ask you, like, when you were called nigger, did you, like, was it a reaction like you were, as if you were being called nigger in America, or was it more so a reaction of, these people are copying people in America, or were you trying to think, okay, why was I being called?
That's a good question, because your question deals with context. So that's all it is. So because I've been in situations where people have said nigger, but I know the context of it. When somebody a cop pulls me into near a cell and says, nigga, we know you're bringing drugs into this country. I think I have a good understanding of the context of what that word means in that particular situation. If somebody says, you know, negative and for a photo or whatever, then I think that's a whole different conversation. What I do is I correct them, because the thing is that now people are becoming more sophisticated and you have information like that word, generally speaking. People who are well-read don't say that word. Yeah, and people who know better do not say that word. So there is an innocence aspect to it, but the word has multiple meanings. It's kind of like, I know when people don't feel like calling me nigger, they'll say abizyan. Oh. You know, which is like, so there are a whole bunch of, you know, like, which is basically monkey for people who don't understand the term. And so it all depends on the context where you are. If I am surrounded by skinheads, which has happened to me several times, I think I know what negative means in that context. So that's what it is. So if I, you know, so you have to pick the environment and the situations. And so most of the time people use the word towards me, there was no malice behind it, but like with the cop,
definitely,
with the skinhead, I think I know what it meant.
Why don't we get a few questions? Rosin, sorry, don't know your name, and Elliot had a couple questions. Maybe we'll answer those and then we'll go to you. Okay.
I'll try to keep this as short as possible, but first, thank you so much for a wonderful conversation, and thanks to Jim for really putting it together. Mm-hmm. I really agree with, you know, pretty much everything that has been said. I would only like to add a caveat, and I would be curious how you relate to that caveat, you know, mm-hmm. which is that there's really nothing principled in this global outright alliance between, say, the U.S. white nationalism and the Russian state, especially as far as the Russian state is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to me, it is really full of contradictions, this alliance, you know, which is a very tactical term, and maybe, you know, too optimistically, I, I expected not to last very long. You know, first, first because of the contradictions, some of which Cenk has mentioned, that there's this outreach to white nationalist groups in Europe and the States via Dugin. There has been also an attempt to co-opt by the Russian state a certain leftist anti-globalist rhetoric, you know, which you can pick up while watching RT. You know, there's some many shows that I watch, and I'm ready to fully subscribe to in their critique of globalization. Which is not a reason why we should give up on that critique, and then numerous contradictions. This anti-fascist rhetoric, which picked up, faux anti-fascist rhetoric, which picked up in the immediate aftermath of the annexation of Crimea, resulted in, had to be at some level backed up by actions, and resulted in a crackdown of many Russian neo-Nazi groups, which had been tolerated in the 2000s. And so if you look at the Sova Center statistics for 2015-16, actually there's a real fall in racially motivated beatings and killings. I could multiply these, but to me this is really a very, very tactical move on part of the Russian state. And there's really no master plan to it, and maybe my hopeful reading is that it's not on the line that it will last long.
Why don't we just gather a couple more, and then we'll... Mm-hmm. I think you had a question?
It's kind of about political strategy. So a lot of the conversation was, by the way, really great. A lot of the conversation was about how restrictive race can be, and Georgians, people from the Caucasus not being considered sort of white because whiteness is associated with being Russian. But I wonder if you guys could talk about, in the wake of the annexation of Crimea, Putin and others made these statements that Russia was going to defend the interests of Russian-speaking people in other countries. So I guess what I wanted to ask is whiteness, as is associated with being Russian, kind of more flexible in the Russian context, and is becoming more flexible as the kind of political agenda changes, right? So all of a sudden, Latvians are Russians or Estonians are Russians because they speak Russian. Like that's the important characteristic. Speaking Russian makes you Russian. Rather than being Slavic,
Russian. I'll tap into that. And I think one of the things you have to realize is that in let's say in Estonia, for example, a lot of these people are Russians. Their nationality is Estonian in some instances. So what's complicated about the Baltics is that for a long time, one of the ways that the Kremlin was able to ratchet up conflict in those regions was because many of the regions had laws where if you didn't speak Russian, you won't become an official citizen, right? And so there were ways in which the state actually used language to kind of restrict certain liberties that or rights that a person had, and that was something that was easily manipulated by the Kremlin. And so you can make the argument. I would argue that. Restricting people's language, it's not a good idea, right? For rights to citizenship. But a lot of that also came from a fear of, they've seen a playbook. Russia, they did it in Ukraine, right? So with Russia, and they did it in the, in South Ossetia and Abkhazia. What's interesting about your question of whether or not race is flexible, consider this. An Abkhazian person, they can walk around the streets of Moscow and easily be murdered. So how is race flexible then? Is it flexible for my political agenda, for territory? Or is it flexible because you're truly a full citizen that can enjoy your humanity in our state? So that's the way you have to look at that. And I want to address your point about this nationalist rhetoric that's being risen. If you notice where all the hacking takes place, they're always taking place in countries that have some type of conflict going on that deals with race. So what's happening, so right now, the German intelligence agencies are pretty much alleging that Russia is hacking its internet networks with fake news, right? And so one example of that was of a fake story of a German Russian girl who was killed. The story was completely fake, but the story ran and covered. And so in Estonia, country you just brought up, one motivator that got that led to the hacking of government computer systems was a statue of Stalin being torn down, because it meant because that statue means a lot to a lot of local people, you know, Russian speaking people in that region. And Georgia, it was the Georgian government did not respect the they did not respect the they felt like the the Abkhazians and the South Ossetians felt like they were discriminated against by race. That was a very racialized conflict. That was not heavily talked about, but that was the case. Again, can Abkhazians and South Ossetians deal with discrimination in Russia all the time? So I don't think race is flexible in that respect. Going on into Ukraine, the same issue. It was very much one that dealt with Russian identity, but it wasn't there to necessarily say, we are liberating our people. It's we're making a conflict so frozen to the point where it will go into perpetuity and we will always have our hand in it. So it's not so much about liberating race and being flexible. Race is about control. That's what racism is. That's part of it. Part of racism's most potent weapon is control. Because there's no rationality behind how you can get someone to kill someone based on their race. It's a control mechanism, and you can use that politically. I don't think that has anything to do with the flexibility of race.
Okay, two comments. This was great, by the way. First, about the N-word, which is always a great conversation starter. I think part of what's going on in the way that it's deployed in Russian has to do with a profound misunderstanding of hip-hop. which is performed in Russia by Russians who are only white because that's what's going to be. So the So what you have then is a complete lack of understanding of, like, you can say it, I can't say it. And there is a popular zombie novel called Armageddon Collapse in the United States, in which has an action movie set up. There's a Russian Itnaz guy, and there's a black hip hop star, and a porn star. They're all like running away from zombies. And the hip hop guy who's speaking in Russian, because of course the novel's in Russian, is always referring to himself as, you know. And so the Russian calls him that too. And there's a moment when the hip hop guy is hanging from a cliff, and the Russian guy shouts, "Hold on!" and then uses that word, which I was trying to imagine this in an American movie, but it was just absolutely impossible. So I think there's just a complete untranslatability. The other thing I wanted to mention is I think we need to disarticulate a little bit American white supremacy and, say, Eurasianism and other forms of Russian conservatism that are not entirely ethno-nationalistic, because there's very little space for a notion of ethnically pure Russia because of empire. So the fact that you see in the visions of people like Dugin and Mikhail Yuryev is really something that's based on the desire for a world in which everything is as big as possible. Like, let's just have three big empires and two religions or three religions and just not deal with small groups of people. But there's something almost aesthetically offensive about having to think about smaller groups of
people.
And
I think that's what Russia's kind of doing with the Russian World Foundation. Mm-hmm. And going back to your point about how it's being used for political purposes, I mean, I think that the Russian World Foundation is an especially good example of how Putin right now is trying to use that shared language and that shared heritage in order to gain influence in the former Soviet sphere. So
I was just saying, to Daley's point, I think it's a fantastic one. This kind of collapsibility of nation state into broaden it out as much as possible. And I think that's one of the primary appeals that Russia currently maintains for American white nationalists. They see this multi-ethnic federation that has, at the end of the day, Russians first among equals, right? That they would like to see replicated within the U.S. And I think just to Natasha's point real quick, I was living in Bishkek in 2014 when this Ruski Mir rhetoric first began ratcheting up and the fallout from Crimea and Eastern Ukraine. And it was, I remember the Russian embassy in Bishkek has this nice placard where you can post entire speeches and they like doing that, all 8,000 words right there for passersby to just read. And I remember, there was a line, and this is to the second question that we had in terms of flexibility, in terms of openness, in terms of applicability to non-ethnic Russians, in that it wasn't Putin directly addressing Russian or Russian speakers, but it was, he also used the term compatriots. So those who consider themselves, maybe they speak Russian, maybe they don't, maybe they're part of the former Soviet Union, probably the part of the former Soviet Union, but they are welcome within this Ruski Mir, and with the connotation being that should they ever need Moscow's protection, they'll be there for them.
Right.
We have just 5 minutes left, so can we just gather the questions? And Josh has the last question, right?
Yeah, okay.
So can we gather just quickly?
Oh, this gentleman, I think he was like at the front.
Oh, yeah,
like,
yeah. Do you want to go first? Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
My name is Edward Powers.
Yeah.
And thank you for the discussion. It's an irony that the most famous writer and poet in Russia, his grandfather was Ethiopian, Pushkin, we know that. A comment and then a question. I like the discussion about separatists. And last week, George Osborne, who was the former chancellor of the Exchequer in the UK, was talking about Brexit, okay? And his comment was that that's okay for the European Union, but the United States model is very different. And a man by the name of Abraham Lincoln addressed that, okay? Last week, I was at a lecture. The speaker was Henry Kissinger. And I asked him a question. And the question is, he's written many books, including China and the current books. And I said, Dr. Kissinger, it's estimated that now there are anywhere between 100,000 and 1 million Chinese living in Siberia on Russian territory. And how do you feel about this? Do you have any comment? The second question you didn't answer, and that's the relationship between Russia and North Korea. If you look at the map, Vladivostok is within almost walking distance of North Korea. He answered the first question, and it was that the Chinese look upon history in a very different way than we do in the West. And we look on something maybe 4 or 8 year cycles, or 50 or 100 year cycles. And he said the Chinese look upon it as 1,000 year and millennia. And that for the Chinese, they consider this territory to be theirs. And so the Chinese are just going home. But it seems to me, imagine if you had, 1 million Germans living in Western Russia, forget it. So anyhow, any thoughts that you might have on that?
Let's gather, and then just quickly. Yes.
Just very quickly, you just spoke about the ethnic heterogeneity in the former Soviet Union. I'm just curious, do you think that white nationalists in the U.S. realize how heterogeneous is? My impression is that they're looking at it as a bulwark of pure whiteness, of racial and ethnic purity. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
I guess in this conversation between how unpure it is, and then Terrell's point about the kind of expansiveness for the purposes of expansion versus expansiveness at the center to who's actually safe and who can be there and has a claim to being there. I was wondering, in terms of anti-Semitism, how much that plays, the idea that the Jews are always the kind of people who pass or are able to pass, and lots of people like Medvedev, he's a Jew, he's a secret Jew. Timoshenko is a Jew, right? You can never accuse a black person or a Central Asian person of passing because their tells are too easy. So in my time in Azerbaijan and Georgia, I'm kind of neutral looking enough, and the name is Irina. And so eventually, though, when people would kind of be like, well, but who are you, like, really?
Yeah.
And they'd be like, oh, yes, I could tell you were Jewish. There was a certain cast to your skin. I could tell. But before, you couldn't tell. But now that you know, you can tell. And so if that's sort of part of the problem, this connection to money and resources and some kind of unaccountable deep state, and then this ability to move into the center and, you know, be undetected until it's like too late. I think of the same sort of narrative about Armenians in Turkey. They're kind of, you know, Erdogan is sometimes accused of being basically Armenian, but more nationalist.
I think we just have time for Josh.
So as I mentioned at the beginning, this is actually being live streamed to the University of Pittsburgh, to their Russian East European Center. So I'm just going to ask some questions that came in from Pittsburgh as well, throw them out to this discussion here. And we can, I mean, I know people are going to start having class and stuff like that, but we obviously can take a few minutes for you guys to answer this last set of questions. And if anyone needs to leave, like really needs to leave to get to class, you can go out the back way without walking in front of the speakers. So, but here are a few questions from Pittsburgh. One question that hasn't come up here was, we've been talking a lot about Dugin and some of the leaders in the conferences, and a couple of times you said, well, this was sort of small, then it got the attention of the Kremlin, and the focus has generally been on the Kremlin's link to these groups. But how, in terms of Russia in general, how, the one question is, like, how fringe or central are these groups of people? Like, the groups we've been talking about here, the far-right groups in Russia, are they, you know, widely popular? Do they have large numbers of followers? So if something could say something beyond just these small groups that are having conferences. A second point, question was raised about the Russian hacking and the activity of the Russians during, and a question was asked of whether there's any of you in your reporting has come across any implication that the alt-right in the United States is trying to collaborate on some of these hacking-based issues. We have, I will say myself, we have heard lots of stories about the alt-right in the United States beginning to harness bot technology, which we know has been delivered and developed in the Russian context. So I personally, from my research, would be really interested in hearing comments about that as well. And then finally, one thing, the final question I would just ask is that, so in the U.S. there's been a lot about the rise of the alt-right, but especially in the last 2 weeks, there's been a lot about the rise of the anti-alt-right, alt-right in the United States, most famously with the ACLU getting six times its national donations in one weekend, right? And so the question is, like, there clearly seems to be a civil society pushback response in the United States to these groups. And the question is there an analogous form in Russia? Is there a Russian civil society pushed back against the alt-right? I could start answering that myself, but I'm going to leave it for the panelists to answer that. So we can maybe take, you know, like another five, or give you guys like a last chance to answer any of these questions that have been out there. We've got a few minutes.
I think I can answer that in like one minute directly. In 2011, we remember the mass protest that occurred in Russia, and we know that Putin, to this very day, blames Hillary Clinton for that. And was probably, and according to the publicly made available intelligence report, it was that Putin pretty much pointed to that as his motivation for hacking the DNC specifically, right? So, to your question, I don't know of any civil society in Russia that exists, especially where, you know, particularly in the past 2 years where the Kremlin, well, the Duma passed anti-protest laws where Black Lives Matter people who are doing the protests that they do can find themselves in jail for up to 2 years. So I'm not sure if any kind of society exists in that regard.
So just to go through a couple of the questions we had just now, as it pertains to ethnic Chinese in Siberia, there's a great book that came out recently called Black Dragon River, which is written by the Beijing correspondent of The Economist. I would highly recommend it if you get a chance. Goes through Russian-Chinese relations along the Amur River, the Blood of the Shins massacre, a whole host of different historical footnotes that haven't gotten a lot of attention, but that are very much worth paying attention to. And I think to that point, the question of secession and cultivation of Western secessionist movements, they're playing with fire, right? Because you're setting a precedent and you're exhibiting support for XYZ secession movements elsewhere, why not domestically? And we've seen rhetoric in the Kremlin with Putin and Nikolai Patrushev saying, well, you know, the West is supporting secession movements here, why don't we do it elsewhere? What happens if, you know, Chechnya flares up again, Dagestan flares up, or Siberia for that matter. Heterogeneity? Yeah, I mean, again, how well read are these guys? I think among the leaders, certainly, people like Spencer, certainly people like Kuprianova, people like Heimbach are aware that there is this is a multi-ethnic federation in which ethnic Russians retain primacy. So in that extent, Yes, I think they're aware. I think there's a good cohort, maybe Natasha can speak more to this, that don't have any idea. They just think only Germans live in Germany, only Russians live in Russia, only Ghanaians live in Ghana.
But again, they would argue that they're not their platform isn't about supremacy of one particular nationality over another, just that they belong in separate spheres, which is I think an idea that Putin has propagated.
As to the questions of anti-Semitism, I had the opportunity last week to write an article, which I'm very glad I had the chance to do, on the alt-right's infatuation with Bane, who is a Batman villain, and I was finally called Jewish for the first time on Twitter, so that's new. Welcome to the tribe. Let's see. So, yeah, I'm sorry, I lost my order here. Was there another question?
Yeah, in the back.
You asked a question about the passing of being Jewish, right?
Yeah.
It was something like
yeah.
The movement into the center is because it's okay to be expansive when it's at your edges, sort of where it belongs.
There's been an interesting phenomenon. Maybe some of you guys have seen this over the last month or two of fake news sites, far right sites, places like InfoWars, saying that those protesting Trump's inauguration are paid off by George Soros. The question is, where does this idea of George Soros as this bête noir come from, and does it stem from either a Russian precedent in terms of blaming the 2011 protests or Euromaidan on Soros, or does it stem from anti-Semitism that predates that? And does that have to be mutually exclusive? I don't know. I don't have an answer to that, but I think you can argue that it stems from the both of them. Are these groups wildly popular in Russia? Certainly. These groups specifically, perhaps not. Groups like the Russian imperialist movement, the World National Conservative Forum.
World National Conservative Forum.
A movement. Rodina, they have their base, but at the same time, they aren't necessarily well known or held in even necessarily high repute in Russia. So their primary focus is cultivating external actors, so actors in the West, in the EU, and in the US.
Can I add on something at one point to that, which is, I don't think that a movement has to have a large political base in order for larger political parties to exploit the fervor of it, right? I think that's an important thing to note. For example, a white supremacist group, the Nazi Party, did not win the White House. Donald Trump did, using white supremacy as his primary tool. So you don't have to be, so it operates in a sense that with Trump, he was able to narrow in specifically on aggrieved white people, like the poor or middle class person who is struggling, right? And so it pretty much ignores the fact that, listen, black people, Latino people, Native American people are also middle class and also feel a certain aggrievement, right? Particularly with how black people and other minority groups have had to navigate the middle class. But white supremacy very much fit into why these supporters voted for Trump. And one primary example of that is a New York Times report from about 3 weeks ago found that most of his supporters in Indiana and Louisiana, states they won by some 20 points, they didn't think, what was the big deal about Russia hacking the election? They really said that. And so the real question, and it goes back to another point too, 53% of white women voted for Trump, a man who said, grab him by the you know what. And I'm bringing up this question too, because during the 2016 campaign, the focus of my coverage dealt with black women, black female voters, and their participation in the primary going into the general election. And what I found, according to several political scientists who study this issue, according to their research, is that many times white women will vote with their race before their gender.
Black women?
White women.
But white women.
White women will vote with their race before their gender. And so it doesn't matter if Donald Trump says, I want to grab them by their what, if they feel like their whiteness is ultimately going to be protected. if they feel like their whiteness is being devalued, because according to their research, their whiteness is more valuable to them than their gender in regards to who has possession of it and why. And so I don't think that, so going back to this larger question, the groups, these fringe groups may never be popular. They don't have to be in order to be effective.
So I think we have to wrap up now, but please join me in thanking Casey and Natasha for